maker of heaven and maker of earth. And in Jesus Christ is only begotten Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, he was crucified and dead and buried. And I believe what I believe is what makes me what I am. I did not make it. No, it is making me. It is the very truth of God, not the invention of any man. God's mighty right hand. I believe that he's returning to judge the quick and the dead and the sons of men. And I believe what I believe. It's what makes me what I am. I did not make it. No, it is making me. It is the very truth of God, not the invention of.
Tradition that does not, as a group, recite the Apostles' Creed on a regular basis. So when that song was released in, 30 years ago probably, it was, in a sense, my first introduction to the Apostles' Creed. That's not exactly fair, but it was what made me sort of sit up and pay attention to the Apostles' Creed. And I love the song. I love that artist. He passed way too, he was way too young when he died. The same artist gave us the song, Our God is an Awesome God, and other songs that we enjoy. Anyway, so I've started this morning sort of declaring our creed, our confession, our big beliefs, if you will, the Apostles' Creed. It is a tradition or a practice here at Priory to do that on Communion Sunday. So let us stand together and recite the Apostles' Creed, in a sense, as a way of our opening worship and our opening prayer. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into Hades. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the fellowship of believers, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. So welcome again. As I think y'all know, I'm from Alabama. Y'all know I am David, the interim pastor here, and welcome to August, and welcome to Communion Sunday. I would like to just open our time in prayer. We don't, again, traditionally do a congregational kind of prayer, but there are a couple of things that are on my heart that I would like to pray for, but let me share with you beforehand. This week coming, the Guelph Christian Community Church that meets in this building on Sunday afternoons is holding a VBS, an evangelistic outreach for the children of the area. So I'm going to pray for that. That's all week. And I added a note to my notes to pray for Kenya. I was in my office just now making sure I had everything together, and a WhatsApp message came through from a young man in Kenya. He's a man we helped through vocational college. He's, I was going to say he's a fundi, which is right in Swahili. He's an electrician. And he is living in a region where he is not known. So he is frightened because the elections. So he is traveling back to his hometown. He said in the text just now, I'm in the shops. You cannot find a nail 4 inches or bigger because they've all been bought to make poisoned arrows. So the elections in Kenya are poised to create an environment for violence. It has already started, and people are fleeing the cities back to their tribal traditional homelands. So it's on my heart. As you know, we have so many friends in Kenya that all of them are concerned, and all of them are sending us messages for prayer. So let me just open our time in prayer, but keep in mind those things and potential things. Father, we are here this morning very much because you have called us here, whether we are conscious explicitly or not. We live in accordance to your will, and this morning your will is for us to gather together. And even if that together is online and watching our live stream on YouTube, we are still together. I know of a number of people who do gather and do watch us from a distance, and I invite you to be with them as much as I'm inviting you to be with us here this morning. Lord, your work continues. Your world is big. Your work continues this week with the VBS that the Guelph Christian Community Church is going to offer, and even some of us have helped and may even be helping in, but as a outreach to children and families. And we just pray for this work, this effort, this ministry that you have called them to. Lord, I pray for my friends in Kenya. I pray for the nation itself, a nation that has some incredibly deep systemic flaws that just about whenever there is election, it leads to an invitation to incredible corruption and incredible violence, violence that we have no idea about. So I give that nation to you, and I ask that the pastors and the preachers and the teachers, our friends, are calling people to repentance and reconciliation, are calling people to Christ and not to the corruption of their society. But Father, I pray for our mourning as well. The communion that we remember your sacrifice to redeem us and your sacrifice that is efficient and sufficient to redeem those children who are coming to VBS, redeem our friends in Kenya, redeem the world, and redeem our communities and our nation. Allow us to appropriately remember and appropriately be thankful for who you are and what you have done this morning. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Pauline is going to come up and extend the blessing to our children.
Good morning. My name is Colleen, and I will be doing the children's blessing for you today. At Priory, we value people of all ages, including children. Part of the way we express this is by offering a blessing to the kids in our church family each week. We encourage parents to give a blessing to their children at home throughout the week as well. If you are with a child or young person, please place your hand on their shoulder or under their hands, with their permission, of course, as we speak truth into their lives. We are going to be reading from 1 John 1, verse 9. May you realize that if you confess your sin, God is faithful and just to forgive you of your sin and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Amen. And just to remember that any time we can go to the Lord in prayer, in good times, bad times, He is always there, and He is always willing to forgive us. And also to maybe people we've offended, we can also ask them for their forgiveness. That makes them happy, us happier, and of course, God happy. And I remember when I was in Sunday school, there was a verse that I still remember, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus is to trust and obey. The children will stay with us for the rest of the service today as there is no program for August, and parents are welcome to go with their children to the nursery or Sunday school room at any time. And for those who are joining online, we've posted on our Facebook some links for free and fun resources for children this morning to give them an opportunity to learn too. Thank you.
It is good to give thanks unto the Lord, that last psalm said. And I've lost my bookmark. This morning's meditation, more than a sermon, this morning's meditation will move us into communion together. As I've already said, we've started this morning declaring, both listening to the song by Rich Mullins and stating together our big beliefs, our confession, our creed, those things that found us as Christ followers. We will end our service as well with a declaration of our big beliefs of Jesus' death and resurrection and new life that he has provided for us through communion. So I want to fill this middle part of the service between the big belief at the beginning and our big belief at the end with simply a conversation and contemplation of thanksgiving. And I guess I don't mean conversation unless you have something you really, really need to say in the middle. It will be one-sided conversation, but a contemplation of thanksgiving. In other words, in my mind, we arrive at understanding and being thankful for the big, big things, but we get there through a movement or a transformation of thanksgiving. We train our minds to be thankful for the little things. We need, therefore, to train our minds, to train our hearts, to look at those things around us every day, the mundane, and learn to be thankful for them. If you wanted to open your Bibles to Psalm 104, Psalm 104, if you don't have a Bible and want one, I will impose on Diane to give one. You can just raise your hand. But Psalm 104 will be the psalm that we will be most focused on this morning. And I'm also taking advantage of this to share some photos and adventures and stories that Diane, Peter, and Nancy and I were involved with over the last couple of weeks. A couple weeks ago now, we did a canoe trip together. We headed about 20 kilometers into the interior of the southwestern portion of the Tomogamy region. And all of us, the four of us, have memories of canoeing in the past. As children and young adults, we would canoe at the cottages and at the camps that we summered at. And Peter and Nancy were canoe trip leaders in their young adult life. Nancy said she'd never thought she'd canoe again. This was 35 years since her last canoe trip. And all of us, in our own ways perhaps, were consciously thankful for what we were doing and who we were with and what we saw. And that's something we all wanted to do before we were too old to do it again. So we anticipated this trip. We planned for this trip. We were talking about it since probably January. We had the books, we had the plan. Diane found a tent and bought it off Kijiji, and we borrowed a tent from my son. And so one room of the house, his tent was set up, and the other room of the house, the Kijiji tent was set up, and we were having fun comparing and contrasting. It was our son's tent that we actually brought, a little bit bigger and a little bit better. But it was something that we were anticipating for, and we were thankful for in anticipation. We were prepared for it. So we packed our canoes with enough food for 4 or 5 nights and days with no cell phone reception, sleeping in tents, and off we paddled. We all anticipated a different part of the adventure. One of the things my wife loves is to be in nature. And her background, as well as mine as young adults, were loons on lakes. And within 1 hour on the lake, up popped 3 loons, literally meters from Peter and Nancy's canoe. And we were a bit behind them, and we stopped and took a bunch of photographs of the loons. Last Thanksgiving, I know you remember this so very well, I spoke about Thanksgiving, as is very appropriate, focusing on this Psalm 104, and I wanted to come back to it today. I thought of communion as our moment to remember, which is scriptural and which we are called to do, but I want us today to perhaps think of communion as our moment to be thankful as well. Psalm 104, verse 1 reads like this. Praise the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty. He wraps himself in light as with a garment. He stretches out the heavens like a tent. A footnote to this sermon is, somebody please explain to me why Psalm 104 changes the point of view from first person to third person after every verse. I'm a trained writer, and this is something you don't do, is change the point of view of the writing. But it changes from, O Lord my God, you are very great. I am addressing God. The next verse is, he wraps himself in light, and I am addressing you. There's an interesting conversation going on between talking to God directly and inviting you to talk to God. That's sort of the end of that footnote. The change of point of view is in Scripture and is intentional, and I'm not sure I fully understand why. But we saw out in the water, we saw nature. We saw the sky even differently. And he wraps himself in light as with a garment. He stretches out the heavens like a tent. And we saw the expanse of the heavens. Let me rewrite that psalm a little bit. He wraps himself in light as with a garment. He stretches out the heavens in a tent. So that first morning we arranged our tent so we could see the east and the sunrise. I wasn't happy that the sun rises at shortly after 5 in the morning. But that was our view outside the tent, was the open flaps and the pink, orange, beautiful sunrise in the morning. Later on in the trip, we explored a bay off the body of the big lake. And it was almost like out of the granite, God sort of dipped his finger and gouged a bay, gouged a cavern with cliffs on either side. Read Psalm 104, 9 to 10. Well, I'm going to start at verse 7. At your rebuke, the waters fled. At the sound of your thunder, they took flight. They flowed over the mountains. They went down into the valleys to the place you assigned for them. You set a boundary they cannot cross. Never again will they cover the earth. And he makes springs pour water into the ravines. It flows between the mountains. In this narrow bay, there were cliffs on either side. And we sensed the power of the water, but the boundaries that God set for them. We were all amazed as we paddled, and if you've seen the granite rocks of Northern Ontario, these tall trees grow out of no earth. They are almost literally on top of the granite. I have no idea how, but they get their nutrients from the rocks. Psalm 104, verse 16. The trees of the Lord are well watered, the cedars of Lebanon that he planted. We saw the trees that were well watered, but we didn't understand how, because they were growing on the rocks. But they were there, and they were everywhere, and it was beautiful. I rewrote it a little bit, and the trees of the Lord are well watered, the white pines of Ontario that he planted. They were everywhere, and they were quite amazing at just how they lived on almost nothing. Whenever the scripture talks about trees, it talks about the birds of the air. So Psalm 104, 17, the next verse reads, the birds make their nests. The stork has its home in the pine trees. As we were leaving, we saw a bird we couldn't identify, and we had to Google it later, but at the top of a, okay, not a pine tree, looks like a dead birch tree, but at the top of it sat a juvenile red-tailed hawk, and it sat there for a long time and allowed us to look at it and examine it and figure out what it was. But we all love these big birds of prey, and it sat there letting us look at it on the trees that God had planted. Late one night, probably 3 a.m. So does that make it early morning or late night? I'm not sure which. We heard in the distance a wolf howl. And then another wolf farther in the distance respond. Now I listened to it to see if the next time it howled it was closer to us. Thankfully it wasn't. But for perhaps not long, but for 5, 8, 10 minutes, we listened to a wolf howl in the distance. Psalm 104, 19 to 20. The moon marks off the seasons. The sun knows when to go down. You bring darkness, it becomes night. And the beasts of the forest prowl and howl. We were in the middle of this, and all we could do was be thankful to God for his creation. Let's stand and sing, Lord of all creation.
To earth and sky, the heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high. God who wanders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy, Lord of heaven and earth, Lord of heaven and earth. Early in the morning, I will celebrate the light. As I stumble in the darkness, I will call your name by night. God who wanders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty, you are holy.
Saturday night came and we were realizing that we had to paddle quite a distance on Sunday morning, so we sat on a rock and sang that song. Rather unharmoniously, I think, and probably not very melodically either, but the four of us sang that song. God of all creation, you are holy, you are holy. We shared our memories, both of this trip, but memories of Scripture. We shared how God had spoken to us over the course of our lives. And we shared a bit of bread and a sip of wine, and we shared communion together. Psalm 104 ends with these words, 33 and 34. I will sing to the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live. May the meditation be pleasing to him as I rejoice in the Lord. That's what we did on the rock in Temagami, is we meditated and we shared and we blessed God, which is a very biblical thing to do, and invited God to bless us that moment. So in a bit, as a congregation, as a community, together we will celebrate, remember communion. But I'm asking us to be thankful as we remember. And what is it specifically, in the communion context, what is it specifically that we are thankful for? See, Jesus said to his disciples, and Paul repeats in the book of Corinthians, as whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. You remember the Lord's death till he comes. And I am adding this idea, and I think it's a biblical addition of being thankful for the Lord's death until he comes. I want to read a section of scripture from the book of Titus. And you don't need to turn to it. You can just sit and, in fact, meditate on it. But Titus chapter 3, verses 3 to 8. And on the screen, probably too small to read, is verses, it says 5 to 8. So I've expanded this. But let me read this text to you. Titus chapter 3, I'll start at verse 3. This explicitly states what it is we are thankful for as we think about and as we remember our communion time. Starting at verse 3, at one time, we too were foolish, disobedient, deceived, and enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures. We lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another. But when the kindness of the love of God, our Savior, appeared, he saved us, not because of righteous things we have done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and the renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that having been justified by grace, we might become heirs in the living hope of eternal life. This is a trustworthy saying, and I want you to stress these things, so that those who have trusted in God may be careful to devote themselves for doing what is good. There's the gospel message again in a nutshell. We were once hated and we hated. And at once we were evil and did evil things, but now we have been washed, renewed, regenerated is another biblical word. Why? So we can devote ourselves to do good. Communion is a, and I struggle for the right word, is a observance, is a celebration, is a ritual, is a rite, is a sacrament. All of those would apply, but it's the moment of our worship that we give thanks and remember thanks and we remember what Jesus did for us. But it is therefore a ritual, if I can use that word, for those who believe, for those who have consciously, explicitly accepted Christ is the language that we often use. In the verses we read from Titus, in verse 5, it says, let me read it. Oh, I didn't do the verses here. Let me read my notes. Who have explicitly and consciously in Jesus, the one who saves us through his mercy, verse 5, and makes us right, verse 7, and makes us heirs to eternal life as well, verse 7. So these things are conscious and real in our hearts and our mind. So the corollary, the flip side to this, when communion comes around, if you haven't made that conscious decision, we invite you to let the elements go by, and it is good and okay to do that. But if you are a Christ follower, you don't need to be a member here, but if you are a Christ follower, you are welcome to take communion with us. Our summer series is we are talking about transition and transformation, both as individuals and as a church. It is movement. It is process and progress in our lives. And to a certain degree, communion marks at least a beginning point, if not the beginning point, spiritually speaking, of this transition and transformation. We consciously accept Jesus, and then I read from Colossians chapter 2, verses 6 and 7, Colossians chapter 2. So then, the so being referring to our belief in Christ, just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live in him, rooted and built up in him. There's the image of the tree again, the image of our garden again, the image of our, even our logo again. We are rooted in him. Rooted and built up in him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with what? With thankfulness. Before we move into communion, let's stand again and sing a couple of songs, declaring who Jesus is in light of what he has done in communion.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. With all creation. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery.
Bill and Sue Woodward to start coming forward. As I said, this is the Lord's table. It is the table of Priory Park Church. So we invite you all, if you have consciously made the decision to follow, we invite you to be part of this. And as a gesture of receiving both the element itself and receiving, again, that which God has for you, hold your hands open like this, and Bill and Sue will put the place the element of the bread and then the cup into your hand as that kind of gesture. So I'll invite Bill, I think, to give thanks for the bread.
Let's celebrate the Lord Jesus together. Father, as we join together around the table of our Lord Jesus this morning, the words of the psalmist come to mind, and we declare their truth together. With you is the fountain of life, and in your light do we see light. Our particular purpose and pleasure this morning, Father, is to thank you for our Lord Jesus, the light of the world, in whom all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge are found. And we thank you most particularly at this moment for the sacrifice that we find at the core of his love for us, and we celebrate that through the bread of this communion table. Holy Spirit, we invite you and welcome you to join us as we take this bread, and we ask that you'll give life to what we do, and that you together with us will enjoy the Lord Jesus and celebrate his name, the name above all names. These things in and only in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen.
Together in community, in communion, we take the bread. Who will give thanks?
Dear Lord Jesus, your word reminds us that in you was life, and that life was the light of people, of us. And we thank you that that life came, and that life has never been suppressed, has never been overcome. And we thank you that that life goes on giving us life. Thank you, Jesus, for giving your life for us, for laying it down. Help us in turn to lay down our lives as you have called us to do, to lay down our lives for one another. Be with us now and renew us by your Spirit, we pray. In your precious name, Lord. Amen.
Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission for sins. It also says that once and forever, Christ shed his blood for us. We will together take it. To stand and in closing, sing the simple chorus. I don't know if we've done it here for a while, but so it may be new, but it's a very simple chorus. Give thanks with a grateful heart.
Give thanks.
his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ, our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen.